to you by Penguin.
Odd Boy Out. Written and read by Gyles Brandreth. The things a man has heard and seen are threads of life, and if he pull them carefully from the confused distaff of memory, any who will can weave them into whatever garments of belief please them best. W. B. Yeats. Best trust the happy moments. What they gave makes man less fearful of the certain grave, and gives his work compassion and new eyes. The days that make us happy make us wise. John Masefield, Biography. It is curious to look back over life, over all the varying incidents and scenes, such a multitude of odds and ends. Out of them all, what has mattered? What lies behind the selection the memory has made? What makes us choose the things that we have remembered? It is as though one went to a great trunk full of junk in an attic and plunged one's hands into it and said, I will have this, and this, and this. Agatha Christie, An Autobiography. Prologue. Permission to speak. What are you up to? My wife popped her head around my study door. She never knocks. She likes to keep me on my toes. I'm writing a book, I said. A book? Her face fell. She's reached the age when quite often she looks more severe than I think she means to, like the Queen, who, when she isn't actively smiling, can look positively grumpy. A book? Another one? Yes. Oh, Giles, does the world really need another book by you? She'd come into the room now. She was looking down at me, bent over my laptop. Sit up, she said automatically. Come on, straight back. I lifted my head. She sighed. I don't know why I bother. I've been saying it for 50 years. You don't take a blind bit of notice. Look at you, you bent old thing. It's like being married to Methuselah. She picked up the cold mug of tea from my desk. I make about 10 cups of tea a day, but I only drink about an inch out of any of them. Why on earth do you want to write another book? I had an answer to that. We need the money, I said. We have 3 children and 7 grandchildren, and haven't we discovered over the years that money is the one thing keeping us in touch with them? She gave a wan smile. And what's this book going to be about, then? Me, I said. Oh, no, she cried. Not again. Me, me, me. That's the story of your life. Perhaps that should be the title, I countered brightly. No one's interested in you, Giles. They really aren't. We know you've got an ego the size of the planet, and bless, you think everything revolves around you, but it doesn't. It really doesn't. Nobody's interested. Nobody cares. They don't even know who you are. A few people do, I bleated. Not that many, she said crisply. Often they don't even get your name right. Charles Branston, was he the jumper man? Countdown, Gogglebox, teddy bears. Wasn't he an MP for a while? They've sort of heard of you, but they're not sure why. She was warming to her theme now. Come on, Giles. Why would anyone want to read your memoirs? Not memoirs, I said quickly. More memories. Growing up, leaving home, that sort of thing. We all have memories, don't we? And never mind whether they know me or not, some of my memories might chime with theirs. That might interest them. She paused. She put the mug of cold tea back on my desk. Memories. She looked at me, not unkindly. And what's your very first memory, then? Her question startled me. I don't believe she had ever asked me that before. And we've known one another a very long time. We met at 3 p.m. on Thursday, 6 June 1968. I wanted her in that very moment, at that instant. I pursued her from that afternoon onwards, relentlessly. She's still here because she's immensely tolerant. I'm still here because I haven't caught her yet. My first memory, I said. I hesitated. The coronation, I suppose, June 1953. I sort of remember being on my father's shoulders in the streets, in a crowd waving a flag. It was raining. And I remember our television. We got it specially for the coronation, hired from Radio Rentals. I remember standing close to the television set, right up against the screen, pointing my finger at the Queen, and my sisters telling me to get out of the way. "Oh," said my wife, chuckling, "we're going to get the Queen on page one, are we? You and the Queen together, in fact. People are fascinated by the Queen. Who was at Buckingham Palace on Coronation Day to do the Queen's makeup?" "Remind me, you have told me more than once." "Oscar Wilde's daughter-in-law." "Of course." "People are fascinated by the Queen. A lot of people dream about the Queen. At least I've met her." "Don't overdo the name-dropping, Gyles. It's irritating. And don't go too heavy on the Oscar Wilde stuff. We all know how you love the 1880s, but we're in the 2020s now. You could do with a few readers under 80. She sighed and picked up the mug again. "How long is it going to take?" "120 days at 1,000 words a day." "If you must, you must. But try not to bang on too much. Remember, less is more." "I'll do my best." I have tried, but not succeeded entirely. This runs to 140,000 words, about half the length of my last book and a quarter the length of the one before that. Count your blessings. "And avoid being too predictable. You always fall back on the same old things, Gyles. Winnie the Pooh and woolly jumpers, how you love words and poetry. If you're going to do this, surprise yourself. Dig a bit deeper than usual." "Really? Should I write about you, then?" "For God's sake, no. Keep me out of it. This is about you. Who are you?" "An egomaniac who can't stop talking, we know that. But why? That's the question." She smiled. "Good luck." As she left the room, I looked down to the screen, this screen, the screen that was blank until 10 minutes ago. A moment later, her head reappeared briefly around the door. "You could begin with your favourite story about the Queen, I suppose. It's quite funny." In the run-up to one of her jubilees, I found myself in the Royal Box with the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh at the Royal Variety Performance. I was writing a book about them, and because, for a few years, I'd been the chairman of one of Prince Philip's pet charities, the National Playing Fields Association, he was president, the Queen was patron, I managed to get privileged access to the royal couple. For several months, I was allowed to walk with them, to talk with them, as they went about their official duties. Sitting next to Prince Philip at the Royal Variety Performance and listening to his banter was rather like being caught in the commentary box at the Eurovision Song Contest with Graham Norton on speed. You got 2 hours of non-stop caustic quipping. Most of it was Greek to me, but I got the gist. In this particular year, the show's finale featured an excerpt from The Full Monty, the stage musical based on the movie about a group of unemployed steelworkers from Sheffield who form a male striptease group like the Chippendales. The musical comes to a climax with the lads doing a full striptease. Everything comes off. But as they complete the strip, as their gold lamé thongs finally hit the stage floor, there's a blinding lighting effect. Bright lights are shone from the stage straight into the audience's eyes to dazzle them and spare their blushes. Bizarrely, this male striptease show was what the organisers of the Royal Variety Performance reckoned the elderly sovereign and her consort, then in their 80s, would really enjoy. Prince Philip glanced down at his programme and saw the word finale. His spirits soared. Below the word finale, he read the title of the final item, The Full Monty. He turned to the Queen and said, "Look, Gabbage, we've reached the finale. And you see what they're doing? The Full Monty. I think we're going to enjoy the finale for a change. The Full Monty. I imagine it's going to be a tribute to Field Marshal Montgomery and the Battle of El Alamein." His Royal Highness and Her Majesty were quickly, sorely and rudely disabused, as onto the stage strutted 18 strapping lads, waxed, tanned, oiled, and wearing nothing but a shimmying codpiece and a couple of golden tassels apiece. They marched centre stage and performed a ludicrous dance to ghastly music, culminating in the full strip-off. Suddenly, they were all stark, bollock, naked. Fortunately, on cue, as their thongs bit the dust, there was the blinding lighting effect, so that you could not see a thing if you were seated in the stalls. However, if you were seated immediately adjacent to the stage in the royal box, you could see it all. And as we know, the problem with naked dancing is that not everything stops when the music stops. The Queen did not flinch. Elizabeth II gazed steadily at the hideous jingling, jangling sight.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.